where do land tenure property rights systems come from? It's really a historical evolution throughout the history of human societies that has generated the arrangements and the types of rights and rights tenure systems that we have in the world today. There's a really good book which I would recommend about this, The Story of Land by Paulson. I won't go into it all, but that book is quite useful for the detail from regions around the world. In general, I think the historical evolution of land tenure and property rights is really one of a kind of move from feudal and tribal systems, feudal and tribal concepts and systems of territoriality that then gradually evolve from situations of land abundance towards situations of increasing land scarcity, and with that move a historical trend towards greater and greater definition and specificity of the specific property rights. So we see these historical rights evolving through various changes in governance and economic systems. And what we really come out with at the present time are these very different complex mosaics in which historically determined rights have been filtered through colonialism, colonial systems, post-colonial independence in parts of the world through the change to socialist economies and then to post-socialist systems. In many places, indigenous land rights coming from original indigenous tribal arrangements are present and maybe often co-present with other types of arrangements. And of course, the emergence of more and more private property systems, especially in the modern periods. So what we see at the current time is really the inheritance of these different historical strands and different systems into a kind of complex mosaic of rights and responsibility. But I think in general, what we would see in the historical record is this movement from more land abundance to more land scarcity, and paralleling that historical evolution, a movement from less defined to more and more defined systems of property rights and more formalized systems. Really, I want to focus then on the Western economics tradition and the ideas of the relationship between land and growth, and seeing land certainly in that tradition as one of the main forms of capital, one of the main types of productive assets. And we can see some of the intellectual bases and traditions already by the 16th century, of course, emerging after feudalism in the Middle Ages in Great Britain. We see starting in the 16th century the enclosure movements, where feudal common areas around villages began to be enclosed by estates into private areas based on the idea of their utility for agricultural production and the need to utilize those areas for crops. So was the idea of efficiency of agricultural production linked with agricultural growth and the key role, especially at that time, of agriculture in generating economic surplus and generating economic growth in the economy. Of course, at the same time, the enclosure movement also saw the rise of a number of concerns about social equity, about the loss of common lands for villages, and questions about environmental degradation. The things, the movements like the levelers and the diggers date from the enclosure movements of the 16th and then again in the 18th century. So as these, I think, ideas, particularly in the early Industrial Revolution, we see then the start of theorizing about the relationship of land to growth, and the early classical economists, particularly David Ricardo, saw land as one of the main factors of production, and seen it really as a fixed factor, limited supply, critical for agricultural production and for generation of surplus. And from Ricardo, we also get then the idea that there may be limits to growth. As the best agricultural land is put into use, subsequent areas of agricultural land become less fertile, less useful, less productive, and we see the idea of diminishing returns, diminishing returns to additional land being used in production, which for Ricardo ultimately, and this is part of the roots of the idea of the dismal science, eventually created the idea of some limitations to growth. So this view emphasizes the critical importance of land in the economy, but also the idea of diminishing returns and limits to growth, which we'll come back to, I think, in talking more about the contemporary moment. So really moving beyond the classical economists, as the Industrial Revolution gained steam in the 18th and 19th centuries, the economic theorizing about land and growth and property rights also evolved. And in the what eventually became more the neoclassical economics tradition, land is seen as having really a central role as a key type of capital in the economy. And in fact, it is in most cases the biggest household asset for most households, and I think that holds globally. So the neoclassical economic tradition really seeks to explain economic growth as a process of capital accumulation. The more assets you have, the more wealth you can generate, the more the economy grows at all levels. Therefore, the recipe for growth in this neoclassical economic view is to maximize returns to capital, and with land as the central capital assets. And in this view, then, clear property rights really become central, because that is the assurance and the security which the capital owner, the landowner, has that investment made on the land, made on the property, will really accrue to the owner. So it incentivizes the secure property rights, incentivize investment, they incentivize utilization of that land asset. And with that, then, the effort to invest in it, to raise the value and the utility of capital, and that then contributes to the process of accumulation and growth.